Thank you to the chairman for sharing time, and thanks for the attention. Okay, this is, let me see how to move. Okay. Okay, thyroid and infertility. Thyroid and infertility is an open question, and now we'll see why. We know that thyroid disease are generally classified in hyperthyroidism, hypothyroidism. And due to the high incidence of among the population, is important to include also the autoimmune thyroiditis. Therefore, I'm sorry, among the subfertile women, we know that quite a large population, that is around 4% of subfertile women, suffer from hypothyroidism. Definition. What is subclinical hypothyroidism? Hypothyroidism is an increase of TSH with normal or slightly decreased thyroid hormones level. So the question that arises is what the range, so what we can call subclinical hypothyroidism. And this is still an open question. Because if you are looking at that NAHNAS, that is the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survive, they consider hypothyroidism a value between 4 and 10. Everything is healthy and everything below 0.4 is considered a pathological, so an hyperthyroidism. But if we are looking at the number, if we know by our clinical experience, can we really consider this value as a condition, subclinical condition? The other answer that arises are, what are the risks for a patient that has a TSH between 4 and 10? So, risk for patients that are with subclinical hypothyroidism is well established by the literature that patients that have a value of TSH between 4 and 10 are compromised fertility, increased cardiovascular risk, there's a higher prevalence of cancer, and of course there is the risk to develop an overt hypothyroidism. But which are the women that are at risk for hypothyroidism? Of course, patients that have prior thyroid surgery or thyroid dysfunction, sign of symptoms of thyroid problem, women of older of 30 age, and patients with autoimmune disorder. And of course, most important for us that are working as obstetrics, patients with history of miscarriage or preterm labor. If we are looking at the guideline of the American Thyroid Association, what they say? They say that hypothyroidism is underdiagnosed, undertreated, or undiagnosed, can contribute to infertility and can result in miscarriage. Several, but not all studies, suggest that treating women with levothyroxine improve pregnancy rate. And we know that the thyroid affects the embryo development. This is a study published on New England Journal of Medicine more than 20 years ago. And we know that the thyroid hormone plays a role in the embryo neuronal development. And in fact, the receptors are present on the placenta. Fetus is depending by the placental passage of T4, and therefore at 10 weeks gestation. And so we are not surprised that the thyroid disease are related to spontaneous abortion. And we know that affect almost 20% of the pregnancy can terminate in abortion, 1 in 5. We know that there is a compromise fertility because there is a correlation between increased TSH and an ovulatory cycle. We know that women with subfertility very often have a high TSH. And we know that even in IVF procedure, the high TSH can compromise the outcome. But please don't forget the immune part of this topic, because we know there is a link between autoimmune disease, thyroid disease, and fertility, but this link is not well defined. We know that is higher, the prevalence of autoimmune disease is higher in women with infertile women, in patients even with PCO, is reported in women even with endometriosis. And of course, on generally talking, we have a lower reproductive outcome. If we are looking at this nice meta-analysis that was issued in Holland almost a couple of years ago, there were 38 articles that were used for this meta-analysis, and we know that subclinical hypothyroidism in early pregnancy is a high risk for eclampsia, and all the obstetric outcome at really lower in patients that are with a subclinical hypothyroid. But if we are looking at the patient that underwent IVF and in vitro fertilization, we know that it's very important to identify patients that can benefit from a treatment with levothyroxine before starting IVF. When the patients are adequately treated, the result seems to be the same. This is another study that report how patients with thyroid immune disease have a lower pregnancy rate, a lower outcome in the IVF, and the study conclude that thyroid antibodies and serum TSH should be checked in every woman undergoing IVF. And they talk about, they report about keeping TSH below 2.5. So you understand that the number is not, for example, what they say from the report from the American Thyroid Association, that the cutoff is 4. In this report, in many reports, is 2.5 seems to be the lower limit. And we know that it's been reported that patients that underwent IVF, they became hypothyroid after the control ovarian stimulation. So then we know that TSH increase in patient in this report 1 up 3. So after IVF, every 2 women became hypothyroid. But I report something, many papers that say that treatment with levothyroxine could be effective, that maybe cutoff is not really clear. But there is a very nice study published on fertility austerity a couple of years ago from University of New York, almost 2,000 patients, and they found no difference in patient TSH more than 25, TSH below 25, TSH more than, 2.5, TSH more and less 4.5, and TSH less than 4.5. So there is no difference in treating this patient. You can see clinical pregnancy, delivery, miscarriage rate. So at the end, which are the recommendations? TS range is the one of the most controversial issue, because upper limit seems to be 4, and lower limit of 4 pregnancy are highlighted. Of course, levothyroxine treatment is indicated with TSH is more than 10, and there is no clear indication, so it's most of the time a doctor choice when the value are between 4 and 10, depends on the existing. So there are other paper that, and most of the paper that I found about treatment of subclinical hypothyroidism have a question mark. Question mark because most of the time the paper try to answer a question. So you see many other papers, they report how levothyroxine could be important, but even there is this other paper that say that levothyroxine treatment in patient with antibodies does not affect the delivery rate. So there's no effect on the obstetrical outcomes. That means that I go back to my first question, if we can consider subclinical hypothyroidism subclinical. I believe, no way, there's no subclinical, and I believe that subclinical hypothyroidism represents a therapeutic gap. So it's something that is not clear which kind of treatment we have. Most of the time we treat our patient based on our experience of an empiric model, but there is a therapeutic gap. And so how to treat hypothyroidism is clear. We know more than 10 levothyroxine is fine, and what's happened for a subclinical hypothyroidism. We know levothyroxine, but don't forget the diet. Diet is crucial for a normal thyroid function. Everybody of us know iodine. We know iodine is essential for thyroid function. In Western countries and the U.S., the diet is essential for a normal apport of iodine. Maybe it is different in other countries. We know vitamin D is and is necessary for a normal thyroid function, and we know that patient with Graves' disease that is known to cause bone loss, these patients are hypothyroid. So thyroid function is essential. And we know that the highest concentration of selenium are found in the thyroid gland. We know that selenium is used for treated thyroid, and diet, of course, is essential. What is selenium? Selenium is a trace mineral that is fundamental for the synthesis of the hormones. Of course, it is involved in the conversion T3 to 4, T3. There is a decrease with the use of selenium in antibody titer and as a cellular procession, and is involved in the oxidative stress. Selenium is being widely used in the treatment of Hashimoto autoimmune thyroidism. This is a Cochrane, and you see there is an antibody titer reduction. And in general, with the use of selenium in patients with Hashimoto thyroiditis, there is a well-being, and even the general mood is improved. On this basis, there is a couple of studies that have reported the use of selenium plus minositol in treating patients with Hashimoto thyroiditis. So you can see this is a patient that has been treated with selenium and before and after, and patient with minositol and selenium before and after 3 months of treatment. You can see the TSH decrease. But most over, the antibody titer decrease. This author in a larger population reported the same experience. So here you are. The use of selenium is effective in reducing antibody, even minositol plus selenium seems to work better, and the level of TSH remain almost the same. So that means that selenium acts mainly on the antibody, while minositol could affect even the TSH. But why minositol? Why they use minositol? Minositol acts as a second message of TSH. That means that works for a TSH level reduction. And this is a basic study research, and we know that there are is effective for the TSH receptor to be bind both. So when we have both receptor binding site, there is an activation of IP3 that is the inositide signal. So a partial activation of TSH receptor induces an increase in the TSH plasmatic level. So this is what we need. So to have a proper thyroid function. This means that the thyroid dysfunction, but maybe it could be a subclinical. And this is not something that we discover today, because this is a study of more than 30 years ago. 30 years ago, regulation of mannositol transport during a differentiation of tyrosine. That means that the TSH induced mannositol uptake in tyrosine. So almost 30 years ago, so it's a very long time that we know the effect of mannositol of tyrosine. It was studied and has been even reported in vivo. This is a receptor mutation in patient with familial mutation on TSH. And they report that the inositol phosphate, so the IP3 cascade, mediates the TSH action on thyroid hormone synthesis. So, in summary, what mannositol does is a precursor of inositol 1,4,5-3-phosphate. This is important. Reduce TSH levels acting as a second messenger. So it's a second messenger. We know that mannositol is a second messenger for for FSH, but it's a second messenger for TSH2. So regulate the iodine organization and reduce the thyroid structure that is stressed by TSH stimulation. Delay avoids or decrease the need for an intervention with levothyroxine. This is another study from University of Pisa. They report almost the same result. They use selenium plus mannositol. And you can see that this preserves the normal TSH range, but there is a reduction of the antibody titer. So the conclusion are almost the same of the previous study. So my conclusion are that we know that high level of TSH affect the reproductive outcome. There's no doubt about this. The use of levothyroxine in reproductive medicine is still controversial in women with subclinical hypothyroidism. We know that selenium has proven to be effective in autoimmune thyroiditis, such as Hashimoto thyroiditis, and recent evidence, recent paper, show how the association of selenium plus mannositol reduce the TSH level in, of course, subclinical patient. And here is a meeting of Congress of Human Reproduction, so my last conclusion that further studies are needed to prove the efficacy of this association in reproductive medicine, of course, in patient that does not need LA4 treatment. Thank you for that.